Hello everyone. So you'll see there's a trend here towards the more philosophical to the more applied, and I'm representing the more applied. So let's jump right in, algorithmic targeting of social policies. And let me start by asking you to look at this image. This is an image of a little part of my hometown, Mexico City. And let me ask you to imagine that you were a local policymaker that has to target social programs, such as a targeted subsidy or a targeted cash transfer. So do realize that that challenge means you need to select which households exactly will receive this program and which households will not. And you have to do that with limited information resources and economic resources. So that's the challenge that we have been focusing for the last 2 years in trying to add value on a group of researchers from MIT and myself. So just to be a little bit more clear, what do we mean by targeted social policies? So there are universal social policies and there are targeted social policies. Targeted social policies are those who aim at only a subset of the population, typically those in a condition of poverty or an additional vulnerability. So examples of these are conditional cash transfers, but also targeted subsidies, tax breaks, targeted scholarships, childcare retirement, pension, subsidized health, food security, etc. So it's really a manifold of social programs. This map here paints in green countries that have the majority of their social budget being targeted. You can see that Latin America is basically covered by that approach, but also most of Africa, Southeast Asia, Eastern Europe. So the developing world targets their social policies. And what's the problem? Well, for instance, in Latin America, it's estimated that there is up to 30% exclusion errors. That means population that should receive a social benefit according to the program rules, but do not. Also 30% of inclusion errors, which is the opposite, as well as unequal access to different subpopulations. So ideally, the design principles for better targeting systems would be: we want targeting that is accurate, we want targeting that is efficient, that is equitable, and that is transparent. Towards that, let's look at the status quo. So ideally, what the law says in most of these countries is that, well, it's simple. You just take the income distribution, the per capita household income distribution, apply a poverty line, and everyone that is to the left receives a social benefit, everyone that is to the right does not. That's what typically the laws say. However, this is impossible because in these countries, most of the population work in the informal economy. That means that income information is not available, expensive, or prone to manipulation. Therefore, since the last 20 years, so here we're not talking about a new introduction of an algorithm, but really algorithms that have been in place for 20 years now across a good part of the world. So what's done is that countries estimate income of households based on visible, observable features, such as the household assets, the services of the household. So a social worker visits the household and takes notes of whether they have electricity, running water, internet, and all of the variables of the sociodemographics of the members of the household as well. So education, occupation, age, gender, disabilities, etc. Based on that, there is an income estimation. And based on that income estimation, there's a decision threshold, which decides which population receives and accesses a social benefit or not. That decision threshold can be more restrictive or less restrictive. And as you can imagine, there's a trade-off here between exclusion error and inclusion error. So this type of curve we call the exclusion error versus inclusion error curve, which is basically very similar to an ROC curve that most of you are familiar with. So you'd like to be on the 0, 0, with no error on the lower left corner. And for example, the universal program is depicted by that point there, which has the maximum inclusion error, but no exclusion error. The no program is on the other corner, and all the interesting region are targeted programs of varying sizes in the middle. So with this concept in mind, how does better poverty estimation methods look like? These are results after a year of collaborating with the government of Costa Rica, where the orange line shows what's the reference methodology, so the previous methodology, and the blue line is the best that we could build together with them. So the impact of this, if you compare point A versus point B, is that we were able to reduce by almost 40% both exclusion errors and inclusion errors by maintaining a constant budget. In terms of people, this means almost 200,000 poor Costa Ricans that were previously wrongly excluded from social safety nets that now can be included. And similar results in Colombia with less percentage reduction, but of course a larger country where almost 900,000 poor Colombians now can be included. Just very quickly, at the subgroup level, we analyzed the change of methodology, whether or not it was beneficial to subgroups of the population. When those bars are above the zero line, that means that there was an improvement, and there was an improvement for urban-rural populations when we split the data by the gender of the head of the household, size of households, regions, etc. So it seemed that the accuracy improvement was true for most of them, for all of the subgroups that we analyzed. But finally, and most importantly, what we call the introduction of a decision support platform for distributed governance. And this was really key, and it's actually the most important part. Why? Because the fact that we improved for most subgroups that we analyzed doesn't mean that the algorithms are fair, none the previous ones nor the new ones. So, but what does fairness mean? We couldn't construct a fair poverty index for all of the social programs that consume it. Why? Because fairness means different things for different institutions, the manifold institutions that consume it. So what are the relevant subgroups to look at? What's the parity criteria that they want to achieve? Or is it parity at all, or more affirmative action and positive discrimination? So different institutions had different answers for this. Hence, and with this I conclude, we developed this platform for what we call distributed governance, where institutions can basically play and assign their own acceptance thresholds according to their program budgets. But not only that, they can split the population according to relevant subgroups, according to their policy objectives and realities, and then basically study and discuss in round tables what is fairness for them, what is fair allocation to assign different thresholds, is it parity, is it not parity, what are the costs involved, and so on, so that they can define that themselves. There are other features that I don't have time to go through right now, but I would be super happy to do it offline. And just to finish, I'd like to restate the relevance of this domain. For example, this is the president of Costa Rica signing the decree saying that all of the country institutions will shift from one methodology to the next. So this is really at scale. And then, well, Colombia will follow soon. We look forward to keep learning from these countries and keep improving with them the targeting that happens throughout our region. So with that, I'll conclude and happy to go to the discussion session.